go with food and drink. We'll start. Tonight's a little informal board training. A vital part of knowing where we're going with the association is knowing where we came from. And so tonight it's to bring us up to date on the history, how the association got started, who was involved in it, and what they got from being involved and what they were able to put into the association. We're going to start off with introductions around the circle, and the ones that are lined up to speak will speak, and then any of the board members that want to join in and say when they became involved and how they got started, they're more than welcome. We can keep this pretty well informal. Shall we start over with this end?
Okay, I'm Rachel Levin, and I'm working in our Congressman Bernie Sanders' office in Burlington.
I'm Joanne Sandoval. I live here at Rock Gate. I'm a member of the board.
I'm Helen McChesney Foley, and I'm an NGRA staff person.
My name is Anne Marie Dennis, and I'm on the board of directors of NGRA.
My name is Jan Stevens, and I'm on the board of the NGRA group.
My name is Jim Dunn. I'm a lawyer practicing law in Burlington.
My name is Donna Russell. I'm current president of the NGRA board and chairman of the PET committee.
I'm Lynn Wittert, and I'm the property manager here at Northgate. And I was also previously a resident of Northgate on the board.
I'm Barbara Page, and I'm a member of the board, also a resident.
And I'm Don Roger. I'm a housing inspector for the city of Burlington.
I'm Howard Amble. I'm on the board of directors of Northgate Resident Association.
And I'm David Blair. I'm a resident here and a member of the NGRA board also.
I'm George Richard. I'm one of the staff of the NGRA.
Okay. I think the plan was to start off with the oldest person that was involved, Rita Evans, but I hear that she's not feeling well tonight, so she won't be able to come. And Ellie Blaze, also one of the past presidents that was involved, will be a little late. So let's start off with the next one in line.
What was one of the family members of the Tenants Association?
Don't you, don't look at me.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Well, that's right.
No.
Speak up, Mark.
Speak.
Why did you come out?
You work with Ellie?
Not what? Really that close.
With someone?
Come on, I don't have any. Wait till Ellie comes. She's got it.
Jim,
just look at us.
Jim,
I'll get us started. I go back a ways with this. I was looking at your timeline on the board, and then I have to go back a few more years to get into things that that I was involved with. I came up to Burlington. I had been in Rutland working in 1974, 1975 as a lawyer for Vermont Legal Aid. And in January of 1976, I came to Burlington, to the Burlington Vermont Legal Aid office. After I got this phone call, I tried to go back to Vermont Legal Aid to check on some dates just to be certain, because this goes back now, 14 to 15 years. And some of you may remember that in 1981, Vermont Legal Aid burned down. It was in the old courthouse, and most of all of the records of the old cases that I was involved in, amongst everything else, was burned. So there really are very few, the case files that normally would be available, were burned up in that fire in 1981. But I did do some thinking about it, and it was a very interesting time in 1976. As a relative newcomer to Burlington, I was not that familiar with Northgate, the complex out here, and the first occasion that I had to become involved in it, there was a younger woman who had two young children living here by herself, living alone, a single parent, came into the Vermont Legal Aid office one day. It happened to be my intake day, so I saw this person, and she had a complaint for an eviction. She was being evicted from Northgate, and so I brought her in, started talking about it, and usually in that kind of interview, you want to find out, what's behind all this, what's going on. And she said that the complaint just alleged that she failed to pay rent and was being evicted. So I just started, and she was just a lovely young woman, and she was a very soft-spoken, and was not the kind of person that struck me initially as, you know, terribly aggressive or angry or anything. And she, in a very soft tone, in a very soft-spoken way, told me that she'd just become completely fed up with things, and she had been complaining, you know, to the owners and complaining, and finally had just given up because, you know, the last time that she had gone down, like a couple months ago, and had done some laundry, the whole laundry, her whole washing machine had filled up with sewage, it all back, and it had been doing this from time to time. And this time it was like just awful. I guess there was, you know, paper, and it was just an awful thing. And she just got completely fed up and just stopped paying rent, and hadn't paid rent that month. And I guess it was now the following month, and she'd gotten notice to get out. And I was just astounded by the story. I mean, I'd done a lot of landlord and tenant stuff, but I just had never heard, you know, it's, you know, it's very soft-spoken, very nice way described as the most horrendous sort of, you know, thing that had happened. And plus, you know, to hear that it had been happening, it had been happening for quite a while, and she'd been complaining, and nothing seemed to be done about it. So, at the time, our office was in the old courthouse, but diagonally across from City Hall. So I went across the street just kind of innocently into the inspector's office, just before his time, certainly. It was when Mayor Paquette was still mayor. It was in 1976. And there was a guy named Ray Wheel, who was the building inspector at the time. And there were a couple of other people. I didn't actually speak to Ray, but whoever it was I spoke to, I asked a very simple question. I said something like, have you had any complaints out there at Northgate about sewage or any kind of sewage backup problems? And someone said, yeah, I do remember it. Let me check the files here. And they pulled out this file and just gave it to me. And in the file, there were a number of complaints from a number of tenants, including this client of mine that I had just interviewed, and all to the city inspector complaining about all of this, but nothing, no follow-up. I hadn't find anything where the city inspector really had done anything about it. So I said, you know, what's happened here? I mean, these are all these letters and complaints. And there were, actually, I guess there were a couple of letters from the inspector's office to the owner saying, you know, please clean this up, you know, but no follow-up, no, you know, evaluation to see if any of the work had been done. And then, you know, the people in the office said, gee, you know, we don't know what's going on. I mean, we just haven't got the staff or whatever. The long and short of it was nothing had ever been done about it. So we went back and we filed the first of several class action lawsuits against the owners of Northgate. This one specifically related to the whole sewage system. And again, to make a fairly long bit of litigation short, they came out, we had experts come out and examine the whole system. And essentially what had happened was they had built the system, when they built all this, they had built it on some sand, and they had laid the pipes that were supposed to flow this way out, you know, and they were either level or in some cases actually flowing uphill. You know, the fact that the old saying that you can't make it flow uphill fit perfectly out here. And in some places it was worse than others. Some of the buildings didn't have any of the problems. Some of the complexes, the buildings of four were just in terrible shape. Well, it was. And, you know, the long and short of it was we did manage to get through this loss, this litigation, a substantial amount of digging up. They had to dig up a number of the septic lines and basically, you know, relay them with the correct slope. In the midst of that litigation, I did meet a number of people out here and became more aware of just how bad the place was maintained. I mean, it was just very little maintenance. You know, it wasn't built real well in the first place, and then by not maintaining it, it had deteriorated rather substantially. And I think in late 1977 or early 1978, having met a number of people and having sort of the beginnings of a tenants group grow out of the first litigation, I ended up in discussions with some tenants that involved Barbara. I believe you were involved in the second with Barbara and Rita Evans and a woman named Catherine Miles. And we ended up filing a second class action, which was really a much more widespread complaint on a whole range. What we did essentially was we took out the housing code and we went through all the things that they were supposed to do, windows, doors, you know, the whole list, the basement, the bathrooms, the whole thing. And, you know, by doing, you know, a spot check of around, we were able to make allegations that essentially almost the entire building code, housing code, the city of Burlington was being violated out here. And that got litigated, again, in the form of a class action over a couple of years. I ended up leaving Vermont Legal Aid in 1980 and starting a practice, a private practice, with some other lawyers from Vermont Legal Aid. And it was continued by a woman named Gretchen Bailey, who was a lawyer at Vermont Legal Aid for quite a long time also. And out of it, we got quite a bit of work done out here. We got a lot of windows replaced and some doors and a lot of bathrooms repaired. And you know, it wasn't really the way to do it in the correct way. I mean, the correct way was something like you folks just did, but it was the beginnings of sort of a militancy about for the people out here that they realized that they had some rights and that they didn't have to tolerate the conditions that they had been living with. People who owned it, as you all probably know, many of you who live here probably know, we have some people from Connecticut, and there are a couple funny stories where, word got back to us that, we might find ourselves out on Lake Champlain with, cement around our feet or something. I think it was probably more of a joke, but there were some very hot and intense times during the litigation. It was costing these folks a lot of money. But by and large, we were immensely successful with it. Again, it didn't solve any real problem. The underlying problem was still there. You still had poor management. But we did, I think, begin the process of making people aware of what their rights were. And, to that extent, I'd like to think that the seeds of what kind of grew out of it perhaps were back that far. That was my involvement.
About the dog, too.
Oh, yeah, it was another lawsuit about the dog. I used to Northgate a lot of times. They came forward at one time and decided that, I know the dogs are sort of still an issue. I'm not sure how this plays. But they came forward at that time and said, okay, just sort of arbitrarily, all the dogs have to go. And we brought the third class action lawsuit alleging that violated people's leases, people who had pets who ought to be allowed to keep them under certain circumstances unless they could show that particular pets were a problem. And if they wanted to phase them out with new tenants, that was their right as a landlord. But for many people, the pets, particularly some of the older people, pets were like, their kids or their only things that they had in their lives, and it was just, really, inappropriate and irresponsible to just tell people on 30-day notice that they had to get rid of their pets. And we ended up settling that case basically along the lines of what we wanted, that we essentially grandfathered in people with pets, and unless they could come forward and show that a particular pet was a problem, then they could not have a wholesale, get rid of your pet just because you happen to have a pet. And, they were certainly free to modify their lease as far as new people came in. So, the three lawsuits that were brought were all successful lawsuits, and Barbara was part of at least some of them, certainly the last one and maybe the middle one as well, and some of the other people that are still here, come active. It's really a pleasure to see that people hung in there and was able to experience the kind of changes that I've seen out here now. It's like a different place altogether.
Jim was talking, Ellie Blaze, the past president of Northgate.
Yes.
Okay. With her daughter, Peggy. Right? We're talking just briefly with what we did when we were in the association.
Ellie goes back. You go back and throw it back in. It's already lost, so it's still by a member.
Yeah, I did. I didn't go. I had a dog. They told me I could have a dog my junior, actually. Then they told me I had to get rid of it. It wasn't until Mayor Sanders came, actually, that we really got going, because we didn't feel we had any support. And we all wanted to come out back in the old days, but they wouldn't do anything. So we, I think what I remember mostly about what really got started was we had a meeting down in City Hall, probably back, well, 1981, we just said that she started the dog fight, I think it was, the, was it 81?
Yeah, anyway, I think the last, was, the third lawsuit was, I think, in 1981.
It was probably about, you know, 80, late 81 or 82 that we started. But.
So Bernie Sanders got involved in that time?
Yeah, people were calling him and complaining about things that were going on, and finally he called a public meeting. And, you know, we just brought all our complaints out into the open, and people were very surprised at what we were going through.
What was the association like when you were?
When I was here? Oh, man. Well, I was actually president for about 5 years. It was very discouraging at times, you know, and, you know, you have 10 meetings and too many people would show up and you're sitting in 265 apartments, right, where is everybody? But we just went ahead and did what we could. And we ended up, we got a playground built, we started a neighborhood watch program, we had teen dances, we had, and my favorite, I think, was part of the food baskets we had each year. And the projects that we had to raise money for these food baskets. Car washes and bazaars and, you know, crafts, fairs and things like that. And my second favorite project was the festival, the North Gate Festival we had in the summertime, in this summer, where we had, you know, live music and stuff like that. We had a lot of things going at that time. I'm so happy to see how things are now. It's great.
Well, if you think of anything, jump right in, okay? Rachel.
Okay, Bernie really would have liked to be here tonight, but unfortunately he had to get on a plane and go back to Washington, the place where the laws are made. So I'm going to read a letter that he wrote to you guys. Dear friends from Northgate, I'm sorry that I'm not able to be with you today, but it's necessary that I be in Washington. My memories of working with the people at Northgate go back a number of years, almost from when I was first elected mayor of Burlington in 1981. Working with the leaders of the Tenants Association, as well as many members of the organization, I am proud that working together, we've been able to accomplish so much. Recall the volleyball games that we played together at Northgate in the early 80s, the playground that we built for the children, the weatherization project through which we managed to get so many from Burlington Electric to make the apartments a little more efficient. Remember our strong effort to stop a very large rent increase request by the management and the fact that dozens of tenants from Northgate spoke out at a city council meeting against that rent increase request. If I'm not mistaken, we managed to significantly lower the eventual rent increase that management received. I remember working with Northgate to establish a condo conversion law in Burlington, which would have made it impossible for the owners of the development to simply sell off the units to the open market at outrageously high prices. Mostly, of course, I remember the tremendous amount of work that went into the purchase of Northgate by the tenants, one of the most progressive and outstanding events in the fight for affordable housing that this country has ever seen. It has been a basic tenet of my political philosophy that this country will not change unless the people, working people, the elderly, women, minorities, etc., begin to stand up and fight for their rights. That's what happened in terms of the struggle for Northgate, and that is why we won. I can recall endless meetings in my office filled with lawyers and bureaucrats who were haggling over this or that aspect of a very complicated agreement. We would not have prevailed if the tenants themselves had not remained enormously persistent, month after month, with all the ups and downs that the process entailed. I am very proud that the housing specialists that we hired for the city of Burlington, people like Amy Wright, Brenda Torpey, Michael Monti, Bruce Seifert, John Davis, and others, provided very strong supportive assistance. As it happens, I play a very relatively minor role in being involved with all of the complicated details of this project. I think the most important thing that I did was to inform the owners of Northgate that so long as I was mayor, and so long as progressive government existed in Burlington, there was no way that they were going to throw hundreds of people out in the streets and significantly raise the rent at Northgate. In essence, we made them an offer they couldn't refuse. Either sit down and negotiate with the city and the tenants, or sit down and negotiate with the city and the tenants. Those were the choices they had. Just remember, imagine Bernie saying this, okay? So much better. Not too surprisingly, they accepted one of those choices and sat down and negotiated with the city and the tenants. Congratulations on all of your efforts. You should be very proud of yourselves. But the struggle is not over. Our people, in addition to affordable housing need, national health care system, which guarantees health care to all, affordable educational opportunities for their children, decent paying jobs, and environmental programs that will keep this planet livable. I'm very proud that I've been able to represent you over the years as mayor of Burlington, and I'm very proud to be representing you in Congress. Thank you all for your help and support, and I look forward to working with you in the years to come. Sincerely, Bernie Sanders. And what I just wanted to add to it is, especially since Bernie's office is in Burlington, his statewide office, his congressional office, I'll leave the number maybe with Helen and with Anne-Marie, but we're really accessible, and you guys should let us know what's going on. Call us, tell us what's happening in the world. And, you know, because the only way Bernie's going to be able to be a good congressman is if you guys and guys like you from all around the state call us. So that's, or drop by, too. We're right downtown in Burlington on Bank Street. But he definitely wants feedback. It's not like now he's congressman, he's not mayor anymore, and, you know, he doesn't want to hear from anybody. It's the most important thing, and it's why he comes back every single weekend he possibly can to Vermont.
Thank you. Thank you, Rachel.
Okay.
Don? Anything you want to
under death? Yeah, well, my dealings with Northgate, I've kind of worn two hats. The first hat, as part of the staff from 1978 to 1982. I basically was hired thanks to Vermont Legal Aid to help get the site back on its feet. When I first came in, it was just right after the sewer lines had been corrected, where there was a lot of water damage in all the basements. There were holes that were still punched out of the walls where they had done all the work. The site was in a real bad mess. I agree with what Jim said. The site was less than 10 years old, and it seemed like it was about 40 or 50 years old just from lack of maintenance. You had bad preventive maintenance. There was no preventive maintenance to speak of. Sewer traps were never cleaned out. Fans had never been cleaned. The slider doors, none of the tracks had been oiled. Just a complete disaster. We set about patching the holes in the basements, taking and replacing a lot of the bathroom floors that were rotting because of the level of the tub was wrong. So all the water, when people were taking showers, water would hit the front of the tubs and run off the tub onto the floor, causing the floors to rot. These were problems that were inherent to the construction of the building. Decks were already starting to rot out in 1978. Complete disaster. I didn't have any Grimmage direct dealings with Jim or with Gretchen. Stuart Bennett was our attorney at the time, and I guess he spent a lot of time on the phone together. And Stuart would call us up and say, hurry up, get this done, because Legal Aid is on our backs again. So it did a lot of good. So, you know, we did all we could with what the money they wanted to give us, and that was a big part of it. There were problems that were there that we just couldn't get the money for. They wouldn't free the money up. But we did what we could in those years when Legal Aid was dealing with us. After 1982, I left the site, and then my next dealings with it were from 1983 up until the present as a housing inspector, which was kind of handy because it gave me a lot of insight when I was coming out and getting complaints from the tenants and stuff. I knew what the problems were that they were telling me about, and I had a pretty good idea of what could have been corrected, what could have been corrected, or what it would take to correct it. So with that, you know, basically when I was getting complaints from the tenants, I'd come out and do what I could to make sure that they were corrected. But it was kind of a hard situation because everything was nickel and dime. I'd get a call from one tenant in 1 week, and then somebody else here I came in, and then it would be another couple of tenants. So with the help of the tenant association, they kind of grouped together, and with that, they kind of empowered people. So when there were violations and stuff, it made it a lot easier for us as a city to get them corrected, because the tenants had power when they were together, and they could go to the management and say, look, we have all these problems with the departments. What are you going to do about it? And they were documented through the city. So that's about all I got to say for now.
I worked with Don here in Northgate from 1979 to 1982. And the owners worked did their job upon crisis. If there was a crisis, they'd deal with it. If it wasn't, they wouldn't deal with it. That's the only time that they allowed us to do anything about a situation is, like Don was saying, if it was at the crisis point. It was just day-to-day management. Oh, there's no money because the owners would pocket the profits. And Don and I would sit a lot saying, we don't like our job and it's really hard to do our job. We did the best we could with what we had. And it was very difficult working for the owners back then. We knew there was a lot wrong, yet our hands were tied. We were being told from the home office, well, wait till it gets to be a big deal. Wait till legal aid gets involved. And that's how they ran their business. So I left also in 1982. And I moved away for 3 years and then came back to live as a resident. And I saw the same thing. The manager who worked here then, she was also trying to get a lot done, and her hands were always tied. You know, she wanted to do a lot for the site, but she was never able to. And they never had consistent policies, and I think that's why the dog issue was such a big issue. They didn't treat anything consistent. It was like whoever they wanted to say yes to or no to, or whoever was giving them the least amount of problems, whoever wasn't calling legal aid or calling the city, they would want that person to be treated differently than the other person. Oh, I'm going back to when I used to work here. As a resident, I got involved with the tenant association when I heard about a possible buyout of Northgate, and I got afraid that I was going to lose my home and not be able to afford to live here. And stayed involved until last January when I joined the management team and started working here again for new owners and new management. And that's the only reason why I came back, is because I could see, well, there was such a drastic difference, there was no question that I would be able to come here and do the job that I wanted to do all along. Been at it for a year, and it's a big difference.
Lynn, when did you get involved with the Tenants Association?
Oh, I look at Anne Marie every time I'm trying to think about something, because she got me involved, and I was just going to pass it on to her. After you left, I came back in 86.
I think we did the survey in 87. So.
Okay, it was 86.
So
I got involved in 87.
87?
Yeah. And should I go into that now or wait?
Sure.
I went to a meeting that Anne Marie was president in, and she was talking about the buyout and how important it was for us to get involved, and I could certainly see that was true. So I started going to meetings a little bit at a time. And before I know it, I was going to a meeting every night at Anne Marie's house in her kitchen. And then did we form a board then? Or did I join in?
There was a board already.
There was a board. And then a couple people moved and left. So then it was Anne Marie and I and one other person for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And, but getting the word out, getting more and more residents interested and involved. And just all I remember is meetings and meetings and meetings and speaking.
Yeah,
City Hall, making sure that they knew that the residents wanted to save their homes. We were representing everyone, and that's what we spent doing, advocating for all the residents.
Mm-hmm. And the management committee?
Yes.
It started with the residents association.
Yes. Started the management committee. It was first to deal with current problems with management. Mm-hmm. Also, our goal was future management, hiring a new management company, and then how to direct the management company once we got the company that we wanted. So the residents interviewed and then eventually hired a management company to manage Northgate. And many other things. Let me, you take it, and then I'll, if I have anything else.
I
became involved in the association. I moved into North Gate in 1981, but didn't join the association until about 84, 85. I started because my kids were young and they were going to a lot of the parties, the Christmas parties, the Halloween parties. It was a safe place for my kids to get good entertainment on those kind of holidays, especially around Halloween. I knew the parties were safe here. I wasn't sure about them going door to door. And kind of moved up the ladder just from attending committees and helping clean the hall after the events up to being vice president, and then started writing a survey with the city of Burlington trying to decide if the residents wanted us to do anything about saving Northgate. What were they afraid of? What did they look forward to? I mean, would they be willing to? Could they afford if we wanted to do condos? Did they want to continue renting? We wrote this big survey with the city of Burlington, and then Ellie tells me she's leaving Northgate. And as vice president, I had to take over. And my first meeting was with Bernie in Ellie's kitchen.
When was that? That was in 86,
just before the survey was finished writing. So
you started the survey in 85?
No, we started the survey in 86, but we met, when I met with Bernie, what, in October or November? You know, he was interested in finding a way to save Northgate, and this was my first meeting, my first politician I meet, you know. I got baptized quick in the association. And then from there, everyone, the city hall just kept giving me advice, go to this seminar, go to this workshop, go to this conference, and they kept trying to get me to learn everything I needed to. They were great, and also Legal Aid helped me out. When residents had complaints, Legal Aid helped me to know the process. BTI also helped me out. What were the renters' rights? I called Don Robert a million times on getting complaints handled here at Northgate. So I was dealing with two issues mainly, getting decent repair done and trying to force the owners to keep up decent repairs until we bought the place. And then on the other hand, going to and meeting with Bernie and a lot of nonprofits and finding a way to purchase Northgate. It just seems like I was going to meetings all the time. I think I averaged something like 30 hours a week near the end of my time as president with just meetings. It was a hard time because a lot of residents would come involved, and because the association wasn't as structured as it is now, they'd get frustrated. There weren't policies, there weren't procedures, and so they'd drop off, and then we'd have to work hard to find someone else to get them on the association. But if it hadn't been for all the other agencies that supported the association, they were so gung-ho about it. Even in purchasing Northgate, if there hadn't been residents going to Montpelier and talking to the Housing and Conservation Trust Fund, they would not have funded it. They wouldn't have backed a whole bunch of nonprofits if the residents hadn't said, we want to find a way to save ourselves, we want to be involved, and we will stay involved. That's the only reason why we got the funding, was for the residents. So it was pretty scary and pretty busy. My kids were glad when I lost the presidency to Lynn. And they said, oh good, you can be home now. That lasted a month, and then I joined another committee, you know, because I wanted to stay involved, and I still believe in it very strongly. And Lynn was able to pull it through the bylaw. It was great.
Make that perfectly clear.
Well, yeah, it was a joint effort, but you know, it took a lot of risk because not only were the residents having to put their life on the line, you know, and going to all these meetings and try to find a way to buy Northgate, but we weren't getting repairs done in our own apartments because management was, you know, using that way to harass us and hopefully discourage us and get rid of us off the association. So we were fighting two battles at the same time. And we did fight a big rent increase. One of Fairfield's biggest tactic during the buyout year was to try to get a rent increase of 28%, and people were paying fair market at the time for their apartments, some of them. And so that would have been almost $100 a month for some residents.
Was that 89 in there?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. 89, 88 was it, 88? And we were able to use some political pressure with Bernie and also with Senator Leahy. He was able to put a lot of pressure on HUD, and they found out that HUD had me visited the site in 2.5 years, and HUD was willing to approve the 28% increase.
It was right during that buyout, that last year they had the nerve to try to raise the rents and all at the City Hall. How many residents were there of us at City Hall at night at the meeting?
I think there were 12, 14 residents that came that were willing to speak to the Board of Aldermen. And, you know, a lot of us came, and a lot of the residents said, well, I'm not going to speak, you know. And so there were only two or three of us that were going to speak. And once we said our pieces, the rest of these residents were worked up. They all had to get up and say something. Yeah. They just couldn't stand by and see the Board of Aldermen not do anything. So, legally, the aldermen couldn't do much, but they passed a resolution in supporting our opposition to the rent increase. We got it lowered to an 8% or a 5% rent increase. So all the political help and all the backing from all the agencies were wonderful. And it showed the owners that we couldn't be pushed around. Even they couldn't divide us by trying to make us fight on one and not have enough energy to do this. Mm-hmm. There were 14 residents that were willing to work on this one issue and one issue only, while the rest of us could continue working on hiring a new management company, and they thought we weren't even doing that. So, and they were real surprised when we never even let them bid.
Asking why we didn't send them a bid proposal package. Well, think about it.
I think by that time, too, you kind of had a tyrant for a site manager. Carol Ravenna had left, and another manager had come in, and she was terrorizing the tenants. People were leaving in tears and calling me up in tears.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. They would, that was Fairfield's biggest tactic out here, because they knew 90% of the complex was single women. Or people that just didn't know the landlord laws, and so they would intimidate, they would use pressure. They would send out letters that, I forgot to put the word intent to evict, and it would just say eviction on the letters, and people would think that was their one and only warning they get before they get evicted out of there. And, you know, many a times I would get these panic phone calls, and I'd have to go talk to the residents and say, just an intent to evict. This means you have options now. You can make choices. You can make a deal and stuff. But they would use that kind of scare tactic to frighten them. I mean, because a sheriff would come to the door and hand them this intent letter. And so it scared the hell out of a lot of residents, tried to force a lot of residents out of here.
And a lot of it was for minor things. It wasn't like they were evicting people for any, you know, gross misconduct or breach of lease. It was relatively minor stuff that I didn't.
Well, a mail lady told me not too long ago that she used to deliver 50 to 60 a month eviction letters, and that we're now maybe 7 at the most a month. So 50 or 60 eviction letters a month, that was just total harassment.
There were lots of little sneaky things they were doing, like someone, a resident, had a fire because the electrical short in the stove, and the smoke detector never went off. The fire extinguisher was empty. The residents had called to complain only 2 weeks before about it, and after the fire, they sent her an eviction notice, trying to evict her. So I immediately went over to her apartment, and as maintenance saw me coming, and they took off in the other direction. Apparently they were on their way sneaking over to her apartment to take out her fire extinguisher and her smoke detector so no one would know that either of them were faulty. So I actually had to take them down myself and bring them to my house in case we needed proof that there was faulty equipment in the apartment. Maintenance was driving away as I was going into the other end of the apartment. It was really sneaky, sly little things, you know, that were really hard to would have been extremely hard to prove if we had to go to court on it. But that was their tactic, to do anything underhand.
On the other side of everything, too, is I think the residents got involved, I know I did, because because Northgate is a nice place to live. It's a nice place to raise children. It's a nice area in Burlington. The apartments are great. Really, we had no complaints except the way the management was doing things and not being able to get maintenance done. Other than that, people were really happy living out here. They were proud of Northgate, and they just wanted to make themselves more proud of it, to work to improve it. And because those are basically the only complaints, and that's a pretty good record considering the size and how many people. There was never overpopulated complaints or complaints like that. It was strictly due to the management and the owner's choice on how to run Northgate.
The best part was when we did the survey, we found out that most of the residents weren't as transient as renters are pictured to be.
Right.
Most of the residents would stay approximately 5 to 8 or 9 years. You know, so we had a pretty stable community, and it was, I think, that helped, sway some of the backers. You know, it wasn't a lot of people that would get up and leave 6 months after we saved the place.
Yeah, a lot of people that didn't finally move, they bought a house or something, so you moved out to the purchase home property.
Yeah, backers like that, you know. Perpetuate the American dream. Northgate was, you know.
But it's true, I used to like to see that.
They didn't leave because they
didn't like the place, where they weren't happy here. They left because they bought their own house and wanted an investment. Mm-hmm. So it does feel important. If it stays that way, that's really, it's a really good stepping stone. Got people out of, subsidized housing because they advanced themselves. And I think that's a trend throughout the country now, to have people move on once, get your start here, and then move on, if you can afford to eventually buy a place.
Any residents want to, how long were you here, Howard?
Well, as I look around the circle, I can see several of the ones who haven't spoken of who I know were here before I was, and I'm not trying to get in ahead. I can see two right across from you, two women especially, if the light say something, I...
Sure.
Joanne?
Well, I've been 13, more than that. My kid is going to be 13 next month. So it has to be 15. Yes, I've been here that long, and I've loved every minute. I love Northgate. I really do. I like everything about it, the people in it. You know, people are not, you have to get a winner, all the time. I have loved everything. People ask me, that's a nice place to live. Come on, see this.
Yeah, Joanne had put in a application for a senior citizen home.
Yeah, in the back garden. Can't leave. No way.
She got approved, was on the waiting list, paid her deposit, came right down to get their stuff out of her apartment. No way, I'm not leaving.
Looked at the view they were going to give her. What was it, a brick wall or something? Yeah, and she said, forget it, I'm staying in Northgate. Yeah.
Well, I don't know what happened. I think management had a lot to do with it. But then I thought, I'm better off here. Where I love this stuff. Because the trees and the grass and everything, the woods, the lake. We have just everything that anybody with a palatial home has, really. You come right down to it. So we ought to enjoy and take good care of it.
As far as I can remember, Joanne has attended every resident meeting and board meetings and
we'll be.
That's right, years from way back.
Find out what's going on.
That's right.
Yeah, because we have one tenant here, and you never knew that had only space. You was on the impression that and the other guy owned it. He hadn't been there that long, but that was his impression. Couldn't believe it. He was on the board, but I couldn't believe that.
Had financed it?
Yeah.
Years, I think. It's a nice place to live. Neighbors are nice. We never really had a problem with any of this on occasion. When they didn't care who they were moving in, we had a problem. But it got resolved. And I never was on the Tenants Association or anything until recently I'm on the board on the grievance committee, which is has opened my eyes. But I really like it here.
I just kind of have a comment and a question. It seems like back in the early days, it was tenants being empowered to make change through the legal process. And then over here, about the time of the buyout, I see a lot of advocacy. I'm hearing a lot of advocacy for tenant participation in the new management. Mm-hmm. I'm not real clear what was kind of like going on in the meantime here. What was going on 84, 85 of the Tenants Association?
So that's when we go to the playground and spend that neighborhood walk over.
So it was kind of like doing...
We were still going to get people involved.
Involved by doing kind of social things to get people, yeah. Okay. So this was also a time when people were really educating themselves.
Beginning to realize that in their lives.
That was about the time that we didn't live here, but Dick Sartell started the Mutt Tenants with Rita and Mai and
Dick
Sartell? Yeah, Frank Street Square, but he and Bernie were instrumental in getting Vermont Tenants on their feet.
So this was kind of like a time when, isn't it like the buyout was real imminent or even being thought of? It was just tenants were kind of...
When we started realizing that.
So here was...
About 86?
Yeah.
And then we needed that.
So there was some kind of grassroots organizing through social activities to get people involved and people, the core group of tenants were kind of educating themselves about tenant rights issues. Does that sound right?
Well, tenants rights issues mostly were on a one-to-one basis. It was Ellie and myself, I think it will help me out a little bit on learning what tenants rights were all about. And when the residents started coming to me, and I would help them on a one-to-one basis.
What was that piece like?
Residents would call up and give me a complaint, and so I'd go and meet with them. I'd bring the GTI handbook, and I'd say, you know, these are your rights, this is what you can do, what do you want to do about the issue? Give them the choices, and make them decide what they wanted to do and how they wanted to go about it. But letting them know, and then some of the residents would go on to meet with management and try to force the issue. And some of the residents did it in other more quiet ways, you know, just want an apology from them.
What did that feel like?
I like that part the best out of everything that was involved in the association. It was the most frustrating because I kept coming up against bad management, but it was...
That was one of my major problems, was trying to be the liaison between the tenant and the, you know, mm-hmm. come to a compromise when it was necessary and just step hard when it wasn't, you know. And that was a tough...
I never compromised. I also let the resident decide what they were wanted out of the issue and
you knew when the tenant called you what they wanted.
Yeah.
I think at that
6 o'clock in the morning, my phone starts ringing.
I think at that time, too, maintenance was getting done out here at that time, right?
Pardon?
Maintenance was getting done. We weren't having too much problem with
they were doing better.
You know, the minor stuff. We still had major problems, but
they were no, we still had some. I mean, I lived in this building over here, and my door is backed up six times a month, at least.
So even one-on-one tenants were winning battles with management, things were getting done?
Yeah, they were getting them better, more again. But see, then we knew what we could do if we didn't.
Yeah.
We knew who to call.
And they did, right, Don? We knew who to call.
Yeah.
But that was the big thing, is knowing that you had support behind you, that right. You know who to call when you were having a certain problem. You know, I mean, before that, we didn't know anybody.
Legal aid helped me find the biggest weapon against the bad management. Was what
HUD, when they have projects, they wrote a book years ago called the HUD Handbook to tell residents how to get what they need in a complex. Only most managers of sites never let residents know that HUD wrote this handbook. Legal Aid helped me find it, and anytime I had an issue, I would call someone at Legal Aid, and they would research that issue in the handbook, and they'd send me the necessary pages. So management always thought I had that handbook in my own apartment. And I would say, according to the handbook, you're have to do this, 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 and this. And they go, oh, God. But it was the biggest help.
See, by about 1985 and 86, that's when things started being critical. Because in fact, North Shore built around the complex,
yeah.
And the 223 D3 loan was coming to termination, so the site went up for sale and potentially could go up for sale. So that's when things started to really happen with the city and with the tenants association out here.
When was the condo conversion ordinance passed?
Sitting on at the time was owned by John Durway, who had sold North Shore all their property to build on. So there's a problem with the buildings sitting on leased land. So Northgate Associates and Greenfield Associates didn't own the land John Durway did. So there was a bit of a problem there that took quite a bit too straight out.
Yeah, took a, one of the sort of the ironies of all this is that 10 years, sorry, after litigation in 1989, one of my partners in my law firm, Neil Nickenberg, and maybe some of you may have met, but Neil became, I think, your lawyer, so the group's lawyer.
The NHR lawyer.
Yeah, and Neil was the deputy director of Vermont Legal Aid back in the late 70s, and he and I started our practice in 1980 together. So, you know, 10 years later, he becomes the lawyer for the group and really did an enormous amount of work. The real estate aspect of it and putting the deal together, sort of the various, it was an enormously complex legal deal.
This was bleeding land too that was
right.
Donated to Durway or given to the Durway family for teaching or something. So
yeah, it was just
back in 1800s or something. So
it was by far and away, probably 10 times the most complex, sale of the property in the state of Vermont at the time it happened. Not that the state has anything like it. Well, I forget what it was, a $26 million sale, but in terms of the complexity of it, various nonprofits, issues around ownership of the land, and those things.
And wasn't the HUD money a big part of the buyout? They couldn't get the money to rehab,
Northgate,
there wasn't
going to
be a buyout.
And HUD was giving us a very hard time to go at the end. And went right down to, I remember my partner Neil was in the city clerk's office. It was like 1 o'clock on New Year's Eve. We had to close on December 31st, before the first of the year, with an open line to Washington, and an open line, to somewhere else, waiting to hear back. Mostly I think it was the HUD people. It was also these people called like Fannie Mae or one of the federal agencies that had to come through with a guarantee, and they weren't sure they were going to do it right up to the very end. And, well over a year to put this deal together, and it was right down to the last few hours.
But we had one heck of a party after.
Well, maybe the deal was so complicated was that because of all the different agencies we had involved, every agency has their own lawyer. There needed to be like 12 lawyers.
Of course, lawyers have to get there and make a difference.
25 people to close it, 12 more lawyers. And they all had to agree. That was the biggest trick. But it worked. I think it was like 20 minutes before the city clerk's office closed. They signed the last paper, called up and said, it's a done deal, you know, file it. So we made it just on the deadline.
Right to the wire.
It was a big dream come true.
And then we had to fight again right afterwards, after the buyout, because HUD said that we closed without some of the rehab money, and they said they weren't going to give it to us because we didn't need it, therefore. So we had to continue fighting.
Discretionary grant?
Yeah, yeah. And unfortunately, the new director of HUD, Jack Kemp, did not like what's called a discretionary fund. It was set up at one time to be like a contingency budget on a construction job, where that if the job goes over budget, they have this fund that they can dip into. And this discretionary pot was supposed to be that way. Originally, it was set up so HUD had the power. Congress saw HUD abusing it, so Congress took it away. And then all of a sudden, the congressmen had the power. HUD saw them abusing it, so when Jack Kemp got involved, it was this struggle, who's going to have control of discretionary funds? And there was no real laws that said who could control it. And Jack Kemp says, I totally disagree with the concept, so therefore you're not going to give the money. And no matter who told him he was supposed to give it, no matter what laws we passed, Brenda Torpy had to work with a lot of people, and she had it written into three separate acts of Congress that had to be voted on before we got the discretionary money. Three acts of Congress, literally, they had to be voted. So it was really another major struggle just to get the money.
So that was post buyout that Brenda went to Congress?
Yeah. Brenda and Leahy worked real hard, you know, having it written into all these bills each time, and firmer, so Jack Kemp couldn't get around it.
Because without the rehab money, this place would have been a failure for you guys to find something that was going that simple really quick. Because you put like new roofs on, new heating systems, new siding, new windows,
new doors,
basically we broke the whole project.
And so the second phase of construction will begin in spring, and that will be the $1.2 million. And as it seems, after the windows and doors, some of the fluff stuff, you know, the new kitchen floors and stuff, but if the project had to put that off and put it in the operating budget, then we wouldn't see that happening for years down the road. Fun project.
And the residents pondered over changing the resident tenant association's name, changing the name of the whole site. We had all kinds of suggestions, and we chose to keep Northgate. And I don't know when it was, but we changed the tenants association's name to the Northgate Resident Association. Northgate Resident Association. Well, and also people were. They were proud of Northgate. They weren't ashamed of what we learned. We decided to leave the name Northgate, although they did have the opportunity. We all did. We're going to do Northgate.
That was right after the buyout, wasn't it?
South Shore. Or
when the board was formed, Northgate, South Shore, Park Place, on the lake.
When the buyout was getting excited, and we were thinking of all different things we could do. It was in 89. Wanted some fluffy stuff to do instead of intense business work.
Anyone else would like to contribute? Howard, if you want to.
I'd like to just approach it from a slightly different perspective, that of a resident who moved here in 1983. And I could name the place, I think probably Don would know what I was saying, the place I moved from. When I moved here, this place was like a mansion. It's maybe hard to believe from what some of what we just heard tonight, but I came here in 83, a good deal of the major repairs had been done at that point, not counting new windows and doors and so forth, but the buildings themselves and the apartment was I was in a palace from what I had been. In fact, the owner of the place where I was, I had to move out because I said to him, either you fix this place or the place is condemned, one of the two. So of course I fixed it up and consequently had to move out. And when we came here, I can't say that I was involved with the association at all. I was a person who was glad to have a home and I was happy the way I was, and why bother getting involved? In activity. In 85, something came up, it was in the papers, widely published, a place called Indian Brooks Apartments in Essex Junction. They were in a similar situation to us as far as they were HUD financed, not quite the same detail, but very similar. And the owner who had arranged a deal with HUD, as I recall, sold it. And when he sold it, the new owner said, I'm going to remodel everything out, everybody goes. Everybody had to go out. That's all there was to it. Was I had been through the same situation in 83. That's why I had to come here, because my place was being redone. And I began to scratch my head and say, hey, what's going to happen here? Am I going to do the same thing all over again? That's strictly personal. But I appreciated having a home to move to. But I can't say as I became actively involved, I began to think about this, and then there began more rumors began to fly about a possibility of this happening here. But no dates, as we hinted earlier, we couldn't lock any dates at all. And so it came to, I believe it was in, as I recall, either late 86 or early in 87, because I heard about the association and so forth, and I began to come to resident meetings, and this whole issue was being talked about at this particular time. And one of the concerns at that particular time was a concern of rewriting a dirty word of bylaws, which just my ears perked up. This is one of my pets in bylaws. And so I became involved with the association rewriting its bylaws. And part of our intent was setting our purposes, which we've all been sharing. We want to have a home to live in. And I wanted to see to it that this didn't happen to others like it happened to me in other places. So I became involved with the association in doing the bylaws. And I can't say I was actively involved in the buyout itself, aside from trying to help out here and there where I could, speaking and so forth. But I'd like to take a slightly different approach, something that's been hinted at all around the circle as well. And that is what a group can accomplish when it's working together. We're here now. That's signing the wall there. We did it. It's ours. It didn't happen accidentally. You're either planning to win or you're planning to fail. And this has happened because individuals, the association, all kinds of groups in the community have all been involved in working together. And there's a long way to go yet. For what we need to accomplish, what needs to get done, but we did it before, we're going to do it again, and I'm glad for Northgate, I'm glad for the Resident Association, and it's, personally, it's given me a home that's still here, it's like I'm still living, I'm not out scratching somewhere, I'm not living out in a tent, or whatever the case may be, because of what the association has accomplished, together with other involved organizations, politicians, businessmen, whatever the case may be, everyone had their part, and I'm glad for it.
I think that brings us to a segue. We see where we've come from, where residents didn't even know they had rights. They learned to fight for their rights. They became empowered, realized that they could make an effort and make big changes to advocacy for participation. And now, as Howard so eloquently pointed out, we're at a point where through cooperation, we've come a long, long way from our roots way back when Jim was first involved, and Dawn, and some of the community people that helped TENS. And now we're residents, we have ownership here, we have a stake. What lies ahead? What's our vision? Where do we want to go from here? What goals do we want to have? How will we work for them? What are the things, Howard's pet question, what will prevent us from reaching those goals? How can we plan for those things? How do we identify them? How do we work around them and through them to the best of our ability? What's next?
There's a saying that And I won't say where it comes from, people might get offended by it. Without a vision, the people perish. Without a vision, Northgate isn't going to continue on, you know, without a vision. And just looking at the buildings, the changes that have come about, a while back there was pictures on the wall of the old Northgate and the new Northgate. Too bad we didn't have them here tonight. The transition is just almost mind-boggling as to what can be done. And looking ahead, looking at some needs, we were looking at the other day in our bylaws committee at the kids here in Northgate. The kids have been stepped on, almost literally, with construction equipment. Their playground is gone. This new phase of our next phase of the playground back in again. I can see all kinds of areas that yes are needs and concerns, but not to look at it from a need and a concern point of view as being negative, but being as a positive opportunity for, hey, this is an area that we can, by working together, create a new situation that meets an answer, that meets a need, that opens up opportunities for our kids to grow, to play, to become. Our kids, when we let them know some of what has happened and they see what's happened here, and encourage them that, hey, this is what people can do working together. And if we can begin to involve them within this organization, man, we can have a dynamic organization for years to come. Now, as I understand the situation we're in now, the way the contract's been signed, it runs for 20 years. I realize 20 years, and I think it's 18 years from now. It really isn't that far away if you begin to look at, well, what can we do now that will assure that this will continue on? These buildings are going to last indefinitely. What can we do to see to it now that they hold up for another 20 years and that they continue, or it's a way to rebuild, whatever the case may be. What can we do together to accomplish this? That's part of our vision.
Contributed their part in helping us evolve. That's exactly what we did. Changed a lot in the last couple of years. A nice way of closing this off is that let's go around the circle, and anyone who's got a vision of where they think the association should go, type right in. Do you think you live here too? You're a resident.
That's right.
One of the visions I have for Northgate is that Northgate will become a resource among itself, not only to empower it to do the things it's done before, but to empower it to care for itself, and also to be a model for the community and to be a resource for the community that's outside of this complex. Some of us have been talking about how we can provide education, how we can provide help for people who live here. And I see that as part of the vision I would have, that somehow we find a way to do that. To learn how to serve, learn how to continue in the spirit of this, but reaching beyond what we've already done.
Well, I just see that the fact that I know over the years in Northgate, as residents here, they were not, socialization between the residents wasn't as powerful, and I'm hoping to see over the years that it will open up more and we have more association between the residents, and to actually see that we can build the power on our own to have this in the community for our kids, you know, and the development that we can turn around and prove to other people that we can sustain our own against government and what have you, and keep low-income housing available. That's my vision.
I said enough already.
I just like to see it keep growing as a place where people are happy, and it's a sense of community stays with Northgate. I hope it stays a place where we don't need a minimum housing inspector out here anymore.
I think the place has changed, and I see the children now.
It's a whole new thing. And I thought it was you. They had to water over there. The kids have been having a ball, and all I could think of was dogs. And you're a beautiful skin you've ever had. But they're enjoying what little bit they have right now.
Building a sense of community. We always talked about that. One of our goals with the tenant association we had back was building a sense of community, and I don't think that ever changes. That always stays. Building and sustaining, I guess.
One of my goals is to see residents really take the ownership, to really sense the ownership that they have, to get involved in making decisions. And for Ellie's benefit, we still have two or three that come out sometimes for meetings. So this past meeting, we had 11 board members and two non-board residents. I'd like to see participation increase. And like George said, you know, to see us reach out to each other as neighbors and meet needs here without having to necessarily go outside of Northgate for resources. Northgate, the population here is greater than some of the small towns in Vermont. And I think that says a lot about what our potential is, what our potential to accomplish is.
Well, it's interesting, you know, I've been apart from it for a while, but just looking at tonight and looking at this timeline, I don't know how many people had just, been evicted without really standing up for their rights prior to 1976, but this woman came in to see me, I think perhaps thought she had, no hope for anything, and yet, took one step, and out of it, there's grown this long timeline. There's, almost a casebook example of an empowerment, that took place, where the people really were able to take control and take substantial control over their lives. And, I think as that evolves, it is an evolving process, and as it evolves, picking on what Howard said, it would be not only important to involve as many, of the adults around and convey that sense of empowerment, because it's beyond just your housing. It's how you look at your whole life and, how you go out and face the world, and you change your self-image when you have a feeling of a sense of empowerment. But also, to develop ways as an association to pass that sense on to your children. A lot of kids that grow up, they feel powerless, and they evolve, in that sense. And a real challenge is, as the organization matures, say in the next 10 years, is to be able to, I think, to pass on that sense to kids as they become kids as they go through school.
I'd like to see more residents becoming involved. I don't know how we're going to do it yet, but I think that's a big thing for Northgate. The residents really have got to understand that they own this place and they have got to get involved.
I see Northgate not stopping at our boundaries and growing. I see Northgate helping the other community, as in the North End, because we've shown them that pulling together we can make a lot of changes. So once we feel comfortable with what we are, then we can move on and help the North End community make the changes it needs to improve itself. That's where I see our future eventually.
I don't know. I feel like I haven't been here a very long time, only about 9 or 10 months. And yet I feel like this is really my home. I live here and I work here. So I see Northgate from two very different perspectives. Personally, I would like to see Northgate continue to be the safe place I feel it is to live, a nice place to bring up my family. And from another perspective, I would like to see some of the amazing things I've been witness to continue. If people do take up the opportunity they have to get involved through the Residents Association, they have tremendous opportunity to learn and grow
appreciate what it means to be a partnership, to be involved in a partnership. It's something really important and different. And that means that we can still work together and we can appreciate how different we are from each other. And I think that's one of the most valuable things Northgate has taught me. I'd like to see other people have a chance to experience that.
Joanne, do you want to add anything else? Rachel?
Yeah, just quick. I think Anne Marie's really on the right track in that a bunch of people out here tried to figure out how to do something which everybody said couldn't be done. I mean, when everybody started, nobody had any idea. You knew what you wanted, the goal to be. And then you said you have to decide how to get there. And I think that beyond making this more of a place you guys want to make it, I think a bunch of people here figured out how to do something that couldn't be done, and that you've got to take it and move it out of Northgate to wherever, whether it's other housing developments like this that are going through the same thing with the state, or the North End, or wherever, King Street, or some other place in the state. I think you have to let people know that regular old people who live here are the people who made it happen. It wasn't somebody coming in and saying, oh, we can do all this, but it was you guys getting together and figuring out how you can do it. And I think that should be really inspiring to a lot of other people. I mean, it's something that's to me. So, thank you.
Starting to get to the point where people are starting to realize that you've got to have an association, you know, and you've got to be able to socialize. So I think it's really going to happen for Northgate after a while.
I went to a lot of conferences when we first were building up Northgate, and one workshop that I attended was on apathy, you know, and it was the most filled workshop I had ever been to. And they said, well, how do you fight apathy? And they said, well, we'll work at it from a different angle here. They had us make a list of three reasons why people don't attend their meetings. You know, they're too tired, they're too busy, what's going to be talked about they're not interested in. And the lady collected all the papers from everyone, and she listed quite a few of them on the chalkboard. And then she said, if you'll notice, she says, no one wrote down apathy. There was nobody that was apathetic about anything. So you have to attack the residents from a different point of view. There aren't anybody out there that's apathetic about coming to our meetings. We have to find the reasons and work on the reasons. And I think we can build a stronger association. Thank you all for coming. And I guess refreshments are available.